friends, welcome to the eighth lecture in the LILA PRISM 2015 series on Transformative Governance. We're delighted that we have Rajeev Sethi as our speaker
this evening.
And this is also a very special evening because we have a very special couple co-chairing this this lecture. This doesn't normally happen. We have just one chair. We always say that the speaker suggests a chair because we go between the chair and the speaker. But we have two people. This happened once in 2013 when Anil Gupta was speaking about innovation. And we had two aspects of this. One was the education aspect and one was the scientific aspect. So we had Kavita Sharma and T. Ramaswamy, who was the secretary of Department of Science and Technology at that time. They were co-chairing, but after that this has never happened. So we are really indeed happy that we have three people whose body of work is really remarkable with us this evening. And we are, today's lecture is going to raise some important issues concerning design and governance, like the interconnections. You know, it doesn't really appear that design is normally thought of as something which is artistic, the concern of the artist, and governance is a different kind of issue, it's a social science issue. But we are trying to see what insights the field of governance, field of design can bring into governance. We are all familiar with the Steve Jobs quote, which says design is not just what it looks like and feels like, design is how it works. So, and we also have, I have another favorite quotation, which is from Charles Eames, all of us know, the India report. He has this quotation, which says, eventually, everything connects. People, ideas, objects. The quality of the connections is the key to quality per se. I think this quality is, think that this quality that we're talking about is integrity, design integrity, with how we govern ourselves, how we look at governance is really integrally linked to how we understand design, how we make these connections, what is the position, what is the status that we are giving integrity in making these connections. So I wouldn't go into the depth of any of these things. I am not qualified. We have three people who have who will make this conversation. I must also say that this series, LILA PRISM series, is also a sort of design for transformation. I would say it serves the purpose of transformation for us, because PRISM stands for five key constituents, principles of transformation. As far as LILA is concerned, this is performativity, relevance, innovation, sustainability, and multiplicity. These are the five words which we actually embedded into this idea of PRISM, even as it's a luminous device. So for us, this is very important. So this, within this device, we have 15 speakers from 15 different disciplines. Ranging from design to health to all sorts of fields, bringing in their insights to think about governance, because it is not an issue concerning one person or another person. It is all of us. We have to really think together in order to arrive at some sense of to make some sense of this whole thing. So I would, without much ado, I would just briefly introduce Rajeev and Raghu. Actually, this is not to be done at all, because most of you know them very well, but still, for the sake of formality, Rajeev Sethi is recognized internationally for his innovative contributions to preserving and celebrating the subcontinent's cultural heritage. For over four decades of work in design, architecture, cultural curation and policy, he has identified ways to bring contemporary relevance to traditional skills of vulnerable artisan communities and informed design practice. This is very interesting, like, you know, the range of his engagement. Through cross-cultural and intermediate curatorial as well as scenographic practices, he's created some memorable artistic endeavors. Some of, most of us have gone to Bombay to airport and seen his work also. Awards and recognitions include Sanskriti Award, Padma Bhushan, Order of Merit by the Federal Republic of Germany, and Indira Gandhi Lifetime Achievement Award for Conservation by INTAC, etc. I welcome you, Rajeev, to this evening. Gurmeet is a conservation architect based in New Delhi. She established, you know, most of you know her, she established CRCI, Conservation Consultancy Firm, in 1996. Since its inception, CRCI has undertaken a wide range of projects within the domain of cultural heritage, conservation and management practice in India. Some of the significant projects undertaken by the firm include preparation of site management plans for the World Heritage Sites of Red Fort in Delhi and Ellora Caves in Maharashtra, conservation and revitalization management plan for the Govindgarh Fort in Amritsar and the Grand Trunk Road in Punjab, conservation plans for historic buildings in the Golden Temple in Amritsar, and in collaboration, she has prepared the management plan for the World Heritage Site of Lumbini, the birthplace of Lord Buddha, in Nepal, etc. There are a lot of things. I'm not listing all of them. The works of CRCI have received numerous awards, including from the UNESCO and the government of Punjab. Gurmeet has been on the jury of Asia-Pacific Architectural Heritage Awards of UNESCO for the years 2005, 6, 7, 2010, 2013, and 2015. She's currently the Vice President of ECOMOS and a voting member from India on the International Scientific Committee of Cultural Tourism of ECOMOS International. Welcome, Gurmeet, to this evening. Raghu, I don't have to actually say anything about him at all.
Please don't.
But still, he took a photography in 1965.
He had to raise the occasion
and listen to everybody. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Raghu. Now, this is actually not really done because I think all of us really know his work. So thank you very much and welcome Rajeev, Raghu and Neeta. And I would request Neeta to begin this conversation this evening. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody, and I'm really delighted to be here to be sharing a platform with one of my mentors, which is actually both mentors, my husband Raghu and Rajeev. And in fact, I did start my, I would say, a creative journey working with Rajeev or under him or when he was doing one of the architectural projects in the Imperial Hotel. And subsequently, of course, our paths crossed several times, and specifically in the Red Fort. But what is very, very special about, you know, maybe I, the way we are sitting actually says a lot about what we do and how we do. And, you know, I mean, I know my husband who sits in a very, very private space of, you know, his creative expression and so on and so forth. And I see myself, when I met him, I was very young, I was just, and, for me, I mean, he inspired my work, my direction, the direction I took in my work and so on, but I engage largely with the public space through monuments, engage with people, and the paradigm I use in my conservation work is community and culture and cultural heritage, and that is an expression of people and continuity in that. Now, Rajeev bridges the two very ends of the spectrum, you know, I mean, that's what I find very, very unique about his work, that he engages with processes, he engages with the outer space, and then he comes from a very, very enriched personal space. So, in fact, I was in Punjab yesterday, I have to go back tomorrow, and I thought I must do this one, I must watch what happens today, because it's going to be quite an experiment to have at least two of them, and then me watching and participating today. And I hope it's going to be conversational, and I'm sure we all find ourselves within that, those 3 points that I've just described. And so if my dear husband would like to say something about Rajeev, or would Rajeev take the floor right now?
I just feel emotional and deeply honored to have two such good friends by my side, one who's been with me, Hamsafar, for 45 years, and the other one who, as I saw, as the most beautiful girl one could ever see in Raghu's garden, with her hair covered with coconut hair on, all in the morning, we were going off somewhere, I can't run, never forget, I said, you know, well, we don't share different people, where is it? But it was unforgettable, I still recall. And more to you, I mean, this could really, we didn't plan this at all. It's your thank you. I mean, I think it's great to have friends in this gathering, but it's so wonderful to see so many young people at the India International Center. I think that is remarkable that you have so many young people. It's like Bishop. Feels like a, for us it would feel very much like we would sit over the last 40 years in a drawing room and chat with each other. And I wish it could come across as that. But I think somewhere along the afternoon, must be about 3 o'clock, I think I got cold feet. And I said, we just can't be so indulgent. We can't sit here and just sort of chat and expect you people to partake of our discussion for the evening. So I hurriedly, literally, put down whatever there was. And I was quite sure that I didn't want it to be a usual kind of lecture, which might become still, but there was things that I've never really shown in Delhi. I've never shown them. So I thought that's a good beginning. There were things that were done about 40 years ago, and I've never publicly shown them in Delhi. So I thought that was something that could be to sort of help us fly over the edge. And so that is what I will do. And I'm knowing Raghu's being uncomfortable about giving a, you know, putting a mic in front of him. I just leave him to jump in and sort of, you know, as it's already free. So although I might stand there, because I speak better when I stand. So I'll stand there, but I'm sure that this is not going to stop a discussion from starting. And it's so extremely comfortable, so many friends in front, and it's a good feeling. But apart from that, so many new friends that I'm seeing, which I've never, never, ever see at the India International Center. It's quite wonderful. So what I will do, Raghu, with your permission and yours, I'll just go and bring out some of these projects. I will tell you very quickly before I go on to there, is that one I found, the whole, my fascination for the pictorial narrative that started very early, and I pulled out some slides that but from 40 years ago when I started to sketch. I was always painting. I started off as a painter before design came into the picture. And then, of course, those became very oriented to the whole aspect of communication, of design, and issues of which I will talk about. And then slowly it leads me on to Shadipur Depot, where I was extremely fortunate to meet an vital group of people who were my learning ground. It was also my Karamchitra, Kurukchitra, perhaps, still is. And Agragu used to be my companion and come off and on. And, I can't remember which, and after a while, those days we had no sense of copyright or whatever. Some of those films, I don't know if those photographs are yours or mine or whose, but they were just there, they're 40 years old, so I have no idea how they were there for everybody. And there was a different issue. You were talking about somebody else's story and you were trying to make it out so that their story could be heard. through design for their issues to come out in the front for those who govern to understand better what is needed. Then, of course, somewhere along the line, much later, and this is what is so fortuitous about this collage, is that much later, I think Red Fort was about 15 years ago. It was 10 years ago. There was it's a conservation issue. There was a huge mess that was being created. And there are very funny links, and I might point them out, but between Shadipur Depot and what happened later on in the Red Fort. And so we'd taken the Government of India to the Supreme Court, and whatever happened is what I will also share. But how in each of this, the need to be able to communicate at all levels, not just to those who we were addressing the concerns, but to those whose issues were being understood by us and they needed to understand themselves about what they wanted to say. So it was communication. And we were being facilitators in that sense. So on that sort of front, I will stand so I can perhaps speak more coherently. Now lights may need to go down a bit. So I was saying, yeah, that's a good idea. This is, dono, bete, aap kisi ek minute piche, dono, mia bivi ko kyu alag kar raha? Aap kisi chale, ek aage. Chalo, chalo. Okay. So you know, the concept of the picture storyteller, I mean, all of us, we have various ways of being introduced. I, as a young kid, with my first peep shows, not of the kind that I saw later when I was older, but really of the kind that we should see, the peep show box, the bioscope, voila, that came into the house and would show us things. And of course, the picture storytellers, that's the Kushan there, and the puppeteers, shadow puppets, strangely, even before I started to look at Kathputli, which became very much people I worked with. But here, you see that Sachi Stupa. Do you notice those twirls? Those are really a patachitra. It's the earliest form of telling a story, a narrative. Those are, if I had a pointer, but you can see them, they're here. That's like the story he's telling below. I chance went to this village when I must have been about, I think, 16 or something, and I went to stay in Midnapur, Anandgaon, and stayed about a week, swam in this pool and drank from it, and was sturdier. And then this village, of course, developed into a real area for Patachitra artists. That sort of, this is much later, this is only now. Searching this field, I went further into the interiors looking for the Jadu Patkas. These are the Santhal people who are like this, like Mochilal and Gobardhan and Haridas. They've never been to the craft museum. They're 80s now. The first time they would travel out from their village was with me. We had to go 4 hours walking into the village to go and find them, to be able to, and an amazingly clear, precise line telling the story. They are the complete artist. They draw, they compare, they create the lyrics, they sing, and they also, they're complete. They're painters themselves, one person. Singers and the lyricists itself. So, and many things that, you know, there's the fish, very muscular in their reinterpretation of what is contemporary. So if the Twin Towers is what they see, then they have a very strong visual way of narrating and, you know, and making a song of it and making something extremely contemporary. We were taking a workshop, in fact, of many of these people in my office when the tsunami happened. And it was in the morning, and by 10 o'clock it became clear, and they began. I saw the process of them writing the lyrics, getting it composed into a song with a vowel, and painting the entire thing that they were looking for the first time in that incredible morning that all of us woke up to. So I did an exhibition called Motion, Myth and Magic, which was, you know, looking at various other forms, Shivyala, the Varangal box people, the box from Kavars. I recall working with Hussein in 1969 on a large cover, this box, which opens up one into the other, into the other. I remember in the Motia Khan area where the Lohars had put together this enormous thing that we couldn't even move. But Hussein being Hussein and me being, you know, my chaotic self, being able to get something going. I have no evidence of what that looked like, because we don't even know where it went, like many things that he did and at that time, which sort of disappeared. So there are from all over the country. Now, I was, as I said, very struck by this idea of telling a story, narrative scrolls. So I used to start, I was painting always, but I didn't really make cartoons, and I thought it was important to talk about this issue. So these are about, they were done in 1971, about just when I think the site experiment was happening, and the apple was being put out into villages which didn't even have electricity. And I thought that it is, some of us took, were very angry about this. And we said, there is no orientation, and how can you push a thing like urban issues onto a village in a way without orientations, etc. So we really questioned the very concept of mass media, and what do we mean by mass, and giving a face to faceless, studying the micro with the macro, and the real concept of communication. At that time there was no wireless, so there was microwave linkages, and I said, all this is going to be nothing else but urban neurosis. And occasionally we'll drop a little ladder for villages to climb on, so that they could, so they could participate in this very one-way dialogue. And of course, at that time, I wasn't really a Luddite, but I did feel that, you know, Spaghetti City was known. We talked about Potapak, these, what do they call these, before Super 8, there were these new videotapes that were, I forget the name, that used to come in and, but, so people would gift these to the villages, but invariably people didn't know what happened if, you know, something didn't work, and it always got locked up. And there was a very basic issue, because television was really spreading, and I kept saying that, you know, communication presupposes a physical condition. And each television receiver then was about 2,000 rupees, which was then the cost of making a well. Now, this is where it formed the protest part of it, that we do need to communicate. We need to be with each other. We need to connect and be able to say what we really want in a world where everything was becoming larger. Mass media was more important than interpersonal media. And these issues were of critical importance to people like us then. We also felt excited by electronics, but we were also disenchanted by its fleeting appearance, here and gone. Maybe we were slower. Today when I look at my grandson, he's born with it. And he relates to electronics in a way that I didn't think we were even, we had no clue. It was too quick. We didn't know how to focus with this thing. So just, I was drawing at that time pictures that were half cartoon, half paintings and things like that. And of course on the concept of diffusing energy, that whenever you have this issue of the television, it could never address the needs of people as what they needed at that time, which is what the Patwas did. which is what the picture storytellers did. So if there's a dowry death in a village, they would immediately pull out the role related to the plight of the poor father who had to sell everything off and show it. So they could appeal to the emotional catharsis of being able to do something like that, was something that we talked about later with videotapes and all. I also felt that it's very important that when we do think of technology, that when we bring up its huge paraphernalia and we give it to somebody who's still, as the ultimate illumination, we have to bear in mind that that person is probably still thinking of a candle. And there was this rather unpopular notion of intermediate technology, which I don't want to get into because this would go on forever. But I was very concerned that the person who uses the candle must understand diye tale andhera. He must participate. Is the diya really working all the way or not? So we invented these boxes that could be, that I did in a workshop in Sweden, where, like, using the Persian wheel idea, they would move and these scrolls would move, which I developed further. And you could see I was very young, this was in 76. I would sit on a bicycle, and I was working then in a village in Rotak, where the village had been given an entire village. They had to actually buy into this village, they had to give money for this village, without the architects ever having visited their village, because the politicians wanted a model village. So they had to make that village to suit the visits of all the VIPs that would come to see how rural development is being effected. And none of these people had been, so I had to work in a village where there was no electricity, and we created these big rolls from which suddenly puppets would come out. And it was like suddenly you would be sitting in the middle of a kitchen, or you could be out into the public chopal, and puppets would come out of the screen as well. So very low-tech means, and by driving a bicycle rather vigorously, I could move 6 screens that would create a sound. Then, of course, Aditi happened in the last century, in the 70s, late 70s, and then in London in 80. And we again experimented with the idea of looking at traditional artists. Now, here are Patuas, the Babuji Kapar people, who are numbering in thousands. But they talk about the legend of Babuji, but without really being able to, when your camel is ill or something, they would go and unload this. But nobody knows Babuji any longer. So we invented a new Babuji Kapar, which is the Azadi Kapar. There is Nehruji sitting in the middle, and there is Maulana, and there's Sarojini Naidu, and there's Sardar Patel and sitting on the side, and there's Gandhi looking rather skeptically from a window on top. And then we invented about 47 songs that went with this, which we were hoping that these Babuji people into villages where this didn't exist. Taking the same idea of Patuas and people who tell stories, we thought the new mediums is all about animation and about electronic, but it always comes from the West. So if you put a dhoti on a Spider-Man, we think that's Indianizing it. But we really don't understand that it's not being, the content is being created somewhere else while they laugh all the way to the bank. It's really not coming from people who can create animation. So we worked with tribals to create these. There was a story on federalism in the year 2060, which was heady stuff. And of course, later on in the Terminal 2, I worked with the Patuas again in this, from the same village where I was, to be able to tell the story of Bengal, which of course is part of a very large mural called Seamless India, where we've had the privilege of working with many artists. On one side is Mulera, which is really looking at this side anyway, looking with Mulera artists, and then in the middle is Desmond and Ramesh looking at the southern gateway. On the east is me looking again with the Patwa artists on the west eastern gateway, and on the north, Nirima Sheikh and Bibi Suresh, working along with all the Kashmiri artists. We had a great time, and this is all part of the Bombay airport. So, the need to tell a story. And of course, very early in life, I learned that everything connects. Vishnu Dharmotra Puran says, if you want to be an architect, you have to be a dancer. to be dancer, you have to be a sculptor. To be a sculptor, you have to be a musician, and everything connects. So it was clear that puppetry, performance, magic, acrobatics, people who would come to my home in Panchkuya Road, again a cusp area between Connaught Place and Karol Bagh, would be the earliest memories. So these, as I said, these peep show wala, box walas, and all would come. And that is when Raghu, who was then working with India Today, and you began to see seminal changes in the way the visual metaphor was being addressed in a journal. There's an artist in all of us, but you knew immediately that this is not about journalism. This is much, much more, because there were layers of meaning that were being added. So we started to travel a lot into the Shadipur Depot, which is where all these people stay. And so here on the one side, the black side, you see them all 30, 35 years ago, and the same people. Raghu kept telling me, let's revisit them. He kept saying, let's go to their villages, but we couldn't manage it, so we put them together in the foundation. So he re-photographed them. So what you see, the black and white ones are there. And on the side, this, for example, is Sangeeta. That's Anardin. Gyarsa, you'll see later. Hero. Our daughter's died already. Namkaran, who's died already. So revisiting the people who have taught us so much. About same time, I think just post the emergency, I had to put together, during the emergency, started then, a plan for the resettlement of all these artists, because they had been literally, physically, part of that whole business of removing the slums and taking them away out of sight. You know, you can remove the poor, but not poverty. But just putting them away. So who could tell that story? So we did this project called Three Stones to Mark the Earth. Three stones, because itinerants just need three stones to be able to cook their food so they can travel anywhere they want to. And this is not padta to nahi. पर गा सकता हूँ हाथ दिखते नहीं पर चमत्कार दिखा सकते हैं भूले बिस्से तो हैं पर बेरुखी का सामना कर लेते हैं बेघर हैं पर चूल्हे के तीन ठिए कहीं ना कहीं तो मिलेंगे सो आई डिड दिस झोली फहराना स्केच टू से दैट दे वर ऑल मंगत वरन दे वर पीपल इवन ट्रेडिशनली लुक डाउन अपॉन मेरी एलन मार्क हु इज नाउ पास्ड अवे ऑल्सो केम एंड वर्क विद अस I think she must have seen Raghu's photographs, so she wanted to say, I also want to be able to go and work in this area. And she did some memorable ones for us for the Smithsonian Institution when I did the exhibition. Some of these are here, some of these are mixed up, I can't remember who's. I mean, some of them are mine, some of them maybe his. It's all a potpourri. So, and those were the days you could do it. So the whole concept of Yoga Shastra and what these kids do in terms of the physical culture, the Natya Shastra, what she shows you is what is in the Brihadarashtra temple. And this is very important to tell the people who are really removing them, saying, yeah, Mangatvaran, Bik Mange Log, Bombay Beggary Act applies to them, soliciting alms through any pretense, such as singing, dancing, generally. Inko sabko hatao yahan se, they're all people who don't really matter. But little seeing her connections to our ancient past. What she's doing is in the Brihadarashtra temple. If you look around the shikhar, the 108 karanas, which forms the vocabulary of Bharatanatyam, is what this girl does on a dusty street, but slightly differently. She may put a glass on top of her head, she might put a candle, etc. I'm sorry, I really had to rush through this. There are some wonderful stories here. You will never see this photograph again. This was I'm sorry, you will see the photograph, I hope, but this you'll never see this lady again. But she was the last of the Madaris, these people who really were hit a nail on the head with their with Abhinika's issue on animals. But their women were the ones who took the temples of Makkah, Medina, and Tirupati temple, wrapped in little jolis, and they would take it to the zanana of the women's home and reveal it to them after they've shown you a picture story book, which you see here. Now the last of those picture story books were buried with the last of the women that died in Neh Fatehpur Sikri. There were hundreds of these storybooks. They don't exist in a craft museum. They don't exist. A whole tradition went with them. I didn't keep them because I was against collections. I was against keeping anything, which of course became a disease later. And I have a lot of excess baggage since. So here are the Golewalas, the Andhra people. I'm not going to go into the detail of the way the performing arts structures are made in the country, whether it's the family-based itinerants or they are from all parts of the country, and I'm not going to have time. But just suffice it to say that by the 60s and 70s, the Bombay film industry played a great role in then redefining the way they were going to present themselves. This document is 40 years old, so if it looks a bit dated in design terms or in otherwise, well, it is 40 years old. There is the family-based itinerants, the picture storytellers, and a typical kind of a travel that they took, for example, in their itinerancy from village to village, every year after year. And these are some of the things, again, I talk about. You know, there's still bhikari. Kaatha tu kunjar chadiyo, kanak kathoro haath, mange moti mile ant bhikari jaat. Even traditional terms, too, ki tu bishak khode pe tu bhati pe chadha, aur tera jo katora hai, begging katora, wo sone ka ho. Aur magar tu mangat hai, tu mangat varan hai. But not seen only derogatorily, but that was part of the system of how entertainers were really looked at. And they were always on the margin, they always lived outside of the village. You know, and they were, of course, they were always the same problems, they're in the middle of the village, blocking traffic, or in a house where Kathputli was being replaced by television. Here's a television. I mean, these are done then, and I don't have a better picture on how they were being slowly marginalized with the so-called development. So Stuti Chor Terleen, Dhoti Chor Bell Bottom, Na Chor Disco, Roti Chor Ice Cream, Gaon Chor Sheher Ki Sadkein, is TV tape or Dalne Ke Zamane Mein Asli Ghee Ke Tel Tamashe Ko Kaun Puche. This, by the way, is Puran, who I'm very proud to say later became a Sangeet Natak Academy fellow. And that's his father, Puran Maluram Bhatt. But he's in puppetry. They finally did recognize this. So there's a world of consumerism. I'm not going to be able to get into this. But we did have to put the issue up to those who governed to say, these are the people you're talking about and who they are. So these cartoonists then were very helpful. So these now did this, showing how these people have to now eke out a living. And have you noticed the hand of the policeman is asking for his little bakshish for disrupting traffic? And what the snake charmers can do in relationship to the work. And this was a basti they lived in, which is earmarked for housing, in which, of course, as we predicted 40 years ago, about 5 years ago, the whole land was sold to... We predicted this 40 years ago, that this land they're never going to get. We've made so many projects and we'll show you, but garibon ke liye zameen nahi. Aur ye hame batana, baar baar, jahan bhi baat karte the. Magar ye jo zameen hai, ye ant mein jaake dikhegi aur chane ke bhaav dikhegi, isme badi badi building banegi. Aur wahi ab hua. Raheja builders ko ye zameen jo kam se kam 1500 crore ki bhi ho, magar wo 6 crore pe dikhi. और उनका उनका कहना यह है कि हम 15-15 फ्लोर के 10 बिल्डिंग बनाएंगे जिनमें इन लोगों को घुसड़ा जाएगा और हम लोग फिर वो बुलबुल जारब के साथ 100 स्टोर का एक बना रहे हैं. एंड व्हाट आई एम टेलिंग यू इज नॉट यू कैन लुक एट द वेबसाइट एंड यू कैन सी द होल प्रोजेक्ट. आई एम नॉट टेलिंग यू समथिंग दैट इज जस्ट दिस इज अ फाइट, दिस इज अ बैटल दैट हैज टू कम अक्रॉस. एंड सो व्हाट हैपेंस टू दीस पीपल. Nowadays, we see fewer and fewer of these pilgrims of joy. Decades ago, they left their villages to come to the cities in search of new patrons. Now they've started to leave their professions. Life is not what it used to be, too much indifference, too many rules and regulations. I'm not going into the details of the letters on the side, how they have to sell themselves, the children, and how they are prone to, this is again 40 years old, these kids are now grandfathers that you're looking at here, where they used to come and settle in Delhi at that time, and we pointed these settlements were there before even the colonies that were made. Patel Nagar and all came in later, but those people got their houses, these people didn't. And of course, why did they want to be in Shadipur, where the old had died? Why they wanted to? So these statements, these settlements are alternative, was what I meant. Our design intervention in being giving people a voice to explain what they want. So this was their first petition, which they made to the government of India, saying why we want to be together. Again, Raghu, if you remember some of your photographs, tell them, because I don't have the original negatives, but I have your prints. It would make them all very rich.
Jo mera wo sab mera.
बड़े बड़े लोगों को जाके मिलते थे, बड़े बड़े लोगों को दिखाते थे, मगर आना तो वहीं था. और ये भी फेस्टिवल इंडिया में भी बड़ी क्रिटिसिज्म हुई कि मैंने दुनिया भर में लोगों को दिखाया, मेरे जैसे लोगों को तो बहुत प्रोत्साहन मिला, मगर ये वहीं के वहीं अभी भी. और इनका जो कथन है, दैट वॉज देन साइंड बाय 138 फैमिलीज. एंड what really happened was that we did get a lot of attention, public attention. There was New York Times that did a huge article of every single newspaper, and there's a whole lot in English papers. I bought in Hindi papers and the papers in different languages. Simon Winchester and The Guardian. For the first time, people were hearing about the issues. And so we really got down to set up a cooperative. We could make a cooperative. The red card here was the first time these so-called Mangatvaran Bhagbik had set up India's first cooperative of performing artists, because of how they got together and how they were able to position, with a little help, their place in society. You notice this was in the lawn of Kamaladevi Chattopadhyay, the below, and I was, just for your amusement, much thinner out here. But there was a whole lot of thing about who are these, you know, how do we register this cooperative? In good, ye doodh nahi bech rahe, ye aap jo kala bhi wo hum nahi samajh rahe kaise bech rahe, but it became India's first cooperative. And of course, that was again acknowledged. So design, communication, positioning to get attention. But in the end, failure. And that is something that we can talk about. But I have failed in everything I have tried to do. And I make this not as a remark for getting away with it, but there has been a failure. And that is the nature of the discussion that we need to have. So there were many things we tried to do. Position their skills along with the 3 hours. We ran schools in that place. We started to do things that they could reach out to the more urban markets with. There was the magic market, there was communication through performing arts, there was all this. But what was missing was we started publishing, we did one book on the snake charmers, but the first thing was to start looking for a settlement. Unless they have a home which they could call themselves, they can come back to, nothing was going to happen. So this was what I first designed, which was a long time back, and quite alone. There was just a few students from the College of Architecture who were friends of mine who would come, and we did the first design of it, which was still an architecture thing, but we got government support that ye kuch kar rahe hain. We talked about ecology then, Sanjay worked, but we realized that basti basna khel nahi hai, baste baste basti hai. To isko hum ye nahi kar sakte ki hum bana de apne aap baithe baithe aur logon ko na involve kare. So then we had a larger group. The Vastu Foundation with Stein and Doshi gave us some money, gathered some more people, there were the Kamats, there were other younger architects, and we started to look at letters through this journey of understanding design. Ourselves also help the people who live in it understand it themselves. So it meant collating it in such a manner that we had to deconstruct the whole process. what is the cooking space, whether it was inside or whether it's outside, where is it related to in the house, what kind of stoves that were made for the different kind of foods from these itinerants that were coming from various places, how the cooking activity was centered around the hearth. I'm not going into the detail, when they were shifted for a while under the flyover, how their activity changed, or how the women's courtyard formed itself, the eating activity, the washing activity, the storage space, which is in the mud hut, and when it goes under a flyover on cement. The storing of a woman, of a male and woman storing, how they've stored differently, from mobile to a more stationary existence, a space to sleep, an afternoon siesta, sleep and privacy on a winter night, on a summer night, a space for toilet, a space for prayers, a space for, praise again, ritual shrines, which also became a very good way for us to show what I'm going to show you a little later, on the decoration and ritual, on aspirations. These were the first models we made on how the village ought to be, and I'm just going to come to that. Plants, at work, a space for recreation activity, men, children, women's privacy, a space for animals, the pet, the domestic animal, the professional partner, the joint family, and again, how the cluster got developed, how the cluster led to the path, how the path led to the street, and how the street led to the territory, how you mark the territory, the guardians of the territory, how you maintain what you have, and how a mohalla develops. Now, these were very detailed studies. Each configuration was carefully documented, so that when we pitch for resettlement, nobody will say, they are all numbers. Inko kisi bhi tarah ghar do aur aage chalo. But we had to tell them that each of them, like when you do a house, you don't, then of course, you still could have some intervention for your home. Now, of course, there's all kinds of housing, but I'm talking about a different period. So the clusters, and I'm not getting into the details of this, it's a different thing, but how the streets get formed, how the one mohalla of one community was but two, to deconstruct the entire family and how they related to each other and make each family a card which could allow them to say why they want to live next to their neighbor and why their relative and why they don't want to. So that in fact gave the morphology a new architecture, because it was although for the poor but devised with specific inputs from those who were being housed, even as they understood what they needed from the housing. Because this exercise was being done together and always being shown together. So that is one construct. Went into a mohalla, went into a larger area, and the whole city of Shadipur Depot. Now, in this, I'm not going into details again, but how the Pandanagar, the Rohini, and the systems of resettlement of the poor had a diametrically opposed view. Those homes, those poor housing, which was made for the with contractors and without the sites and services schemes, invariably got very little density in the house. And they were like neighborhoods which are not a neighborhood. They were just put like a lottery. Tumhara number ek adhiya, tumhara number ek adhiya, jaake rehlo. Well, Shadipur Depot, the density in the house became much more. The areas within the courtyards became much more, and there was a greater community. The same thing we followed in Jaipur. Now, none of these things could happen. Now, the next stage. First was consciousness, building of what it means to design. The next stage was to reinforce the memory of what it means to make your house. So we went back with the community leaders to all the places they left two generations before, letting them understand why they built what they did, so that the urban intimidation of building a home in a city could be put to rest. And they could do something with their own map of that. This book has been measured with the hand. And so this process of them becoming barefoot architects, where they started to draw their plans. These are the Masets of Andhra, who said how they want to be. then how they want to create their own neighborhood. But we knew that these drawings are a little, they're exciting, but they're not going to be realized in different ways. So we start going into models. So each person started to make their own model. We found the model making became very male dominated. Men were the ones who were cutting paper and doing it, till women started to say, and all these started to happen in the courtyard itself. And then, of course, translation in different terms of what it would be. Now, they had, of course, Kalakul, a special school for children whose minds wander. Why can't our acrobats become Olympic champions? And what are the things? They're fearless and confidence, precision and skill. It's the same man who's threading the needle with his feet, going backwards in a yoga. Responsibility and adventure. Household chores and educational resource. Parent skill as educational resource. Creative play and group activity as educational resource. Supplementary resource of the 3 R's. We had started schools in the community. Now, the museum of the itinerant, because all the references are okay for people like me who have access to all the museums, but there was nothing in the neighborhood that could give them a sense of history as to who they are. So that was collection of all their position in the field of the art in history. We collected a lot of things that could become a place of pride in their own neighborhood, which could also then invite tourism. Tourism is very much part there. For them, it's a way of life to perform. And people, if they don't come, what do they do? So having a place which they own, which they can rent out to those who want to come and learn with them or come and see them, was direct benefit, rather than sort of put them up like a Disneyland. Now, I was going to tell you, I'm going to go to my next project. But the acknowledgements, I noticed this afternoon, I had acknowledged, and it's somebody here, let me see, I acknowledged Jagmohan. Let me see, who was my bet noir for my next project? Let me see. Had it not been for the attentiveness and keen responsiveness of Sri Jagmohan, the Honorable Lieutenant Governor of Delhi, the scheme may have been long shelved. And I take it to the next part. This was, I was taken to Red Fort by a friend of mine. She's not here, though, I haven't mentioned her name, to see it where she was asked to do the furniture for the new restaurant. Of course, it happened to be in a place which was actually the Princess, later in the British time based the Princess Club, but it was clearly a Mughal monument. It's now serving still as a restaurant. And on that trip, I just went a little further and I noticed that there was this fellow repairing the whole work in a rather rushed manner with a big bag of white cement. Now, anybody who's a conservation person here said, there's something wrong with this. So I took with my little mobile phone this photograph and I started to explore this further, which then became a design document to put out to the court. Now, you're still using design to explain to judges who will never understand till it's visually, very clearly earmarked. It was the most difficult case because it was the first time we were taking the Archaeological Survey of India to the Supreme Court for the so-called renovation or restoration or whatever of the Red Fort, a principal monument. Now, it was important because they were only touching the Palace of Raghu. There are lots of people here, Nalini is here, who will have lots of memories of what happened post. We will talk about that if there's time permitting. But the issues which were very important as public-spirited group of citizens, we draw your attention to the reckless renovation work in the Red Fort. We present here with evidence of a cavalier approach to conservation that perpetuates a chalta hai attitude towards scientific discipline. The present works at the fort violate international norms of conservation that could disqualify its bid to achieve any heritage strategy. Ad hoc measures of beautification in the name of restoration attack both protected material heritage and the cultural identity as a society. Of course, we're talking to intangible resonance. I'm not going into the Venice Charter and in how many ways they were, because India is a signatory to that, how they were completely going against the very idea. We're just talking about the palace around you, which is the Nahere Behisht, which you go on this one side, which, you know, goes from the Shah Burj to the Rang Mahal. And of course, the Hayat Baksh garden next to it, which is completely wiped out. And then by then I had learned to do my, I think those little cameras that come in. What do they call those? Clicks, the small ones. So I could take them with me and shoot them without people really noticing, because I'll tell you why it became an issue. And every day we were recording what they were doing and being able to pull down the plasters and how they were not doing anything which is in the norms of conservation. But to tell you how they were replacing it with these cookie cutter designs, because there's no reference left. And then to show you how you know, this became from verse to verse. Here is the great symbol of Delhi, the scale of justice, Jali. Now this is what it was, this is what it became. And now I took this photograph and I went and showed it to the archaeological survey. This is before we took it to the Supreme Court. And immediately they got panic stricken. So the next day they went to repair it. Notice the circles, they broke it more. Now it is very important that design comes into service to document something that explains what is happening. Otherwise, and if you don't have that eye to be able to see it, those who govern will not follow. But how misinformation takes over after that is another issue that comes later. The Diwani Khas, how the marbles were being replaced, and I was very closely examining each of these, because being in the craft discipline, it was very possible to see how shortcuts were being made. But you need to put this into the Supreme Court file. Then they said to me, but Sethi Saab, ye to itne bade bade kagaz de rahe hain, hamare to file mein fit nahi aate, aap inko A4 size mein pe likh lijiye. I said, hum nahi karenge. Paisa hum de rahe hain. Hamara jo document hai, aap isi ko document kijiye. अगर मैं इसको छोटे कागज में बना दूंगा आप लोग देखेंगे नहीं. सो दे हैड टू एडमिट दिस इनटू द ऑफिशियल कंप्लेंट फॉर द पब्लिक इंटरेस्ट लिटिगेशन. फ्रेंड्स ऑफ माइंड, वी ऑल गॉट टुगेदर, वी मेड दिस इनटू अ बिग इशू. एंड ऑफ कोर्स जस्ट टू टेल यू हाउ द हयात बख्श गार्डन, हाउ दे मिसरेड सो मच. देयर वाज अ लुक एट दिस, द नहरे बहिश्त. Even in the British time, they dealt the fire like a flower garden. But this is the earlier part that was all excavated. This is what it became, these scallops. Now, what it was before were these cornices that were all thrown out. Ritesh Nanda was a young kid then. I think some of these too. So he bought some of these, and we will... This, look at the way the government misrepresents. You see a photograph of May 2002, but when the shit hit the ceiling, the photographs on top were given to say that of February 2002, claiming that they were February 2002, that this is what we excavated with those scallops. It's not true, because in May they were still clearing it out. So it was important to point out that these were discrepancies, and soon enough we found out that they were taking references from something that had no bearing. And I had to sketch all this out to show how the steps are being wiped out, etc. The whole hydraulic, material hydraulic system, is again Ritesh Nanda's photographs, were being wiped out. The areas where water would be kept was being covered, where there was a big moti mahal, the foundations rubbed off. The emperor would go out of his hammam and fall into the pool, you know, and that is the idea of how this thing, and then there were these pumps inside the camp to fill it with water, and then back to my infamous white cement bag, which I said, this is a leak, you won't do it. And of course, as poetic justice, when Jagmohanji was visiting to see kya bakwas, kyu logo ko itna utsaya ja raha hai, galat cheez kyu batai ja rahi hai, they went to see it and they had to fill up the water completely to make it work. And when they filled the water, of course, the whole thing began to leak through the foundations. But it was very important at every stage to challenge what is going to happen. Look at this, the Savan Badho pavilions. Now, this is an early photograph, and these are the fountains in front. This is the earlier one, thrown in the flower bed, replaced by the new one. Now, what is actually happening? You're really disempowering the skill of traditional craftsmen who number in millions. You are polluting their way of looking. And it's important that they see how they are being devalued by contractors, by those who want to make a quick buck. The kind of pavements that are there, and this terrible tendency in the government to beautify everything. So these Mughal lights, I don't know what Mughal lights mean actually, but Mughal lights were being put in all these Hayat Bakshi garden, and how these, you know, lighting and how frescoes were being covered. And even as the case was being heard in the Supreme Court, the arrogance with which structures that had a protected status because they were earlier than 100 years were reduced to rubble. So that very quickly, I'm sorry I have to really rush through two ideas, but they do link two important associations. One, which is the present of our past, which me and Raghu experienced, and the other on the future of our past, which is really about conservation, which is where somebody like Mita is making some remarkable headway. I feel very privileged that she, you know, I've known them for so long, and I don't think they've seen this too. So I think it's important that I, you know, showed it to them. I don't know, these things get lost. We get lost in all our labyrinths, and sometimes we don't connect with things that have brought us so far. But having said that, we should now... Where do we have time, Tom? We do have... So what we can do is, if I may invite Raghu and Mita, will you come and sit here together, and we can either take this same configuration, there may be perhaps the audience that wants to find out more, or we can talk to each other, either way.
Well, my better half has a few nice points to share. What you explained.
How do you know you're a better half? She say you're a better half.
No.
Please come.
Half is
better. Vivanta Kuchu.
Vivanta
Who's better half?
Sadhar will always talk about Sadhar.
If I may say something just to maybe provoke. I think Rajeev undermines his work by saying that he's failed at it or he's a failure because he hasn't been able to maybe have the Chaliput Depot the building happen there. I think that is a terrible line to say, because I would say, what is the indicator of failure? Because, no, here I would say something else, because it's too short a time to really say that he's failed. Because, I mean, I look at myself, that I see him as a mentor. I don't know how many people's lives he's actually touched through the work he's done, the processes he's done, and we've kind of touched and gone out. I think that, to just sum it up to say that he's failed, I think is a bit of a very harsh
statement. I must insist, I was not being cute. It is true. I have gained, I'm sitting here in front of you. I have my list of awards that were announced. These people are exactly where they were, perhaps worse. So something has gone wrong. Now, it could be there's greater awareness in other people about other things, but is it showing up in the fabric of things? Is it really showing up in the urbanism that we are inheriting? Where is a place for these marginalized people who have got absolutely valid reason not to feel vulnerable? So I do believe that we have failed, because even in our effort to try and make it as communicable as, and believe me, I'm showing you the English versions, there are many versions that were all in Hindi. There were hundreds of workshops in the villages themselves with pictures. The only thing I didn't do is publish them as books, because I still felt books were only read by a few people, and I didn't do that. That may have been a mistake. We never published books. We just went on. So I do think we did, and I say that with a sadness, not with an idea that some backhanded compliment. I really do think we failed. Is there anybody else who would like to ask anything? Do you feel that... did you have a good sleep? Are you all students? Are you students of architecture? Architecture? From? Okay, well, mass communication.
Okay, I have a question here. A phrase like transformative governance, really, how many of us really understand that? And I think, would anybody like to say something about that? Or, I mean, I ask this question for a particular reason. Because anybody wants to know, any of the young journalists want to take a, maybe a call at that? Can we demystify this phrase?
I think it's something I am not prepared, but I think I have to. I do feel that what is the subject is a subject of relevance, and it is a subject which must be understood in depth, and I think it has something to do with our souls, and you see, when we look at the subject, which I feel has everything to do with what the subject attracted me very much, because it's something I have been working on. That is the it's something tangible or intangible in our heritage monuments, and how it relates to, say, the culture gap that was the gap of the past, and how we link it with the present, and how it can connect. It is something that we, and whatever I think has been said about communications as they used to be, and electronics as it is now, because I am also more of the that of the old school of thought, and I do feel that the present generation, what it is doing is, it is you know, animating at the same time also trapping the soul, and then trying to see something that goes on in between, trapping, animating, and it is hurting us more than anything else.
Do you want someone to respond to that?
No. We have to think differently, take a different road, and I think the best is to begin with the still, say, photography, and then try to integrate everything and see where we've got wrong.
By the way, we have hours and hours of films. We've got time to show that. It's not just a today photographs because of Raghu, but there are hours and hours, there's films and films and films about this. But I think that question is so potent about interpersonal and the medium that they are studying. Would some of you like to respond to that?
I'm working on distance learning, and I feel that interpersonal computer that we do have is something.
Interpersonal computer? I never heard that.
Yeah, because obviously everything goes on online. Interpersonal in the sense that we network and all like they do, you know. So it's not interpersonal.
हमारे ज़माने में जब मल्टीमीडिया कहते थे, तो हम कहते थे कि ऐसे एग्जीक्यूटिव नाइट्स में नाच गाना सब एक साथ देखें. फिर मल्टीमीडिया took on another turn. हमें समझ में नहीं आया क्यों
मल्टीमीडिया.
Interpersonal is not that computer. I didn't know that.
Interpersonal is not, but interface with the screen.
Yeah, I don't think it's interpersonal. I think
it is not at all.
I think that word we should guard.
Yeah.
Yeah,
we should definitely not. Interpersonally, it is not.
It is not. But I think the link and the gap is somewhere between something of we have to think differently, where we have to, you know, because we carry, if we carry mobile phones, we do not see the wires. So we are all are actually wired. And we see the birds have left and everything, so it becomes a very, very desolate situation. And if we do not think differently, I think we are on the brink of a virtual disaster otherwise.
Okay, so maybe one of them wants to respond.
What about the younger one?
Hello, my name is Ravi Kaushal, and I'm from IMC. The thing is that I wanted to share some experience with you. Like you have had the experience with working with artists and Saripur. I wish to inform you that there is a disheartening news that I met one of the artists, a new artist, who was performing in a cafe cum bookstore that's called Mayday Book Cafe, which is there in Sadipur. And he told me that I don't wish to pursue this further. He's a magician. So it's more disheartening when a person who has been, I mean, who have been responsible for carrying out that legacy is backing off. So this is a disheartening thing. Another thing, sir, the thing is this, the last Indian History Congress had raised questions about the very restoration projects of historical monuments. And it has, and many eminent historians have challenged it. So how do you see a role of design in addressing it? And another thing is this, particularly when you are talking about urban spaces, you see boxes. You don't have that.
There are no homes left.
Yeah, you don't have that you don't have that manifestations of creativity into it. And you find straight box homes. So how would you see the, do you see it as a decadence of design, as far as urban spaces are concerned?
Of course. Mm-hmm. But do you want to take up the issue which you picked up on conservation, whether design can really assist in it?
Actually, there are too many thoughts that are coming to my mind at the same time. You know, the point is, like, I would still like to, you know, there are two ways of engaging when we look at not just design, but even our creative expression as a way of life. One, of course, is when you're talking about patronage from outside, you know, top down. That's what my personal journey informs me. And the other is that unless something happens through you, you cannot empathize with the process. I mean, you're talking about the magician. I don't feel very sorry about it. Now, we have to also, if you are a creative person yourself, you have a journey. When you're looking at that person as an outsider, you have this thing of feeling sorry for that person. Now, I have a bit of a, now, for me, if I look at my biggest learning in creative processes and design is, I mean, I'm going to sound like a Sikh here, is the institution of seva. You know, there is a public space there. There's a space for a creative expression of an individual. And it comes out, and it is a space where people from all hierarchies, all sensibilities, all whatever journeys are there.
That is prescribed. And it's prescribed.
See, it's not prescribed.
It's a self-expression.
Of course, there are certain tasks there. And, you know, nobody's telling you how to polish a shoe. Nobody's telling you you have to do the upper or you have to clean the bottom. Nobody's telling you whether you can take half a bucket of water or just a spoonful and clean something. Or sit there and meditate or do something else. You know, there is symbolism and then there is your own personal journey. Now, when I think about even the people at Shadipur, of course they needed some help. But I would still say it's their personal journey. So if as an external agent, you're trying to make a difference, what principles are informing your process and how somebody else, and I would not look at them as poor people who need help. The point is you recognized something that they could do with and you did your bit.
but then the rest is also their personal journey. I may be oversimplifying it, but no, here when I ask the question about the transformative, whatever this is, governance, the point is, what is your personal transformative experience while you participate in a process?
I think it's partly to answer that question. I think a governance that responds to the time that there is and to the issues that are raising. And it is transformative because it is transformative as a democratic tool itself, which is not just listening to the people themselves, but us, empowering them to be able to become part of that system. Now, I think this is a, we won't go into words, but I just wanted to tell you that I think the issues are that in spite of the people, in all this thing we were doing, people were, I know this and I'm saying it to you, you have to take my word, extremely part and parcel, became extremely coherent in their demands and were able to put it across unlike they'd ever done before. And they felt the energy of a collective catharsis, where they knew what it was all about. But there's a growing indifference of those who govern. There is a growing shrinking of their sense of responsibility, of delivery systems. But that is a system too. That's a system we have to address.
But then
what went wrong? No, we failed because this is still us. No, we will let them. We let them, we bring them. Something has gone wrong.
The contrast and contradictions are unbelievable in this country. The contrasts and contradictions are unbelievable, and the gap is becoming much larger. And also the effect of globalization, and that fat guy, moneyed guy, with dreaming about those big buildings, his dream will come true, not yours and mine, and not the least of those guys over there, because they cannot relate to them, and they are lesser human beings. You see, Mother Teresa said something very beautiful, that we can give them food, we can give them shelter, but have we been able to give them the dignity of a human being, which is the most essential aspect of any civilization? And that's what is not happening in this country. We don't treat those people as human beings.
And yet we elect them.
Well, that will go on, and this time the Nitish and Lalu will be out and BJP will be in, because the previous government, their misgovernance, their loss is your gain. And same thing will happen in Delhi. The BJP will go and they'll bring back the same old people. So that what we inherited, you know, this inheritance has become more powerful than the heritage you are talking about, and nobody cares about that heritage. I'm sorry to say this, you know.
We can't end on that note.
No, you can't. But certainly these youngsters. But what is so nice about this country, and what is so nice about a bit of that globalization, is the Facebook, the internet, and all these young guys and young minds are connecting and putting out messages through their humor, through their anger, and they are far more, you know, have greater awareness than we've ever had.
That's true.
And that is something going to change many things, maybe another 10, 15, 20 years. For just now, it's still the process.
So technology that we were a little wary about, we didn't know, will come to help in a way that will help people connect more and empower them more.
So the bottom line really is that, look, there was something happening. I'm talking about the red fort, we're talking about the quality of conservation. You know, what was happening, there are archaeological survey of India on the face of it is archaeological engineers and there are archaeologists and so on and so forth. What the group Rajeev represented has a certain understanding of visual sensibilities, materials and so on and so forth. Huh? Now the point is, what skill set Rajeev and his group has is something which ASI should naturally have. It's something which we as Indians should naturally have. You know, the artisan who's actually the same craftsman who's making that fountain should naturally have. Now, point is, who is at fault here? There's something wrong in the way this whole, all the agents or all the participants, everybody's slipping somewhere. Now, similarly, I would, like, you know, I got involved in this project because ASI was asked to do a public procurement process and appoint a conservation architect. Now, I wouldn't say that I guarantee that I have all the visual sensibilities and all the engineering knowledge and so on and so forth. It was also because when I looked at the Red Fort, I realized that it's not the story of just Shah Jahan. ASI was, now I'm just telling you about, and I'll be happy that in my generation, the fort has been there for 1638 to now. What is my contribution? I made some management plan that's online. But I feel very good about one thing, that when I looked at the layered history of the Red Fort, the question was, Agra Fort is a World Heritage Site, the Lahore Fort is a World Heritage Site, these are all Mughal forts. What is so different about the Red Fort? Now what was very interesting was, when we saw the layering, the fort became a garrison. For me, the interesting part started was when the East India Company came in. I mean, Shah Jahan's work is beautiful, I can see that. And I know, I mean, I did not stop there. And then we looked at what all did they do. They bulldozed half of the world city, the Shah Jahan, the Red Fort. The pictures of late 19th century with cannons there and what all had happened, and even, you know, the arcade of the Norbert Khana area, which was all pulled down and so on. So pictures are there. What was even more interesting was we saw that, okay, they brought in the railway line and how they were bringing the supplies into the fort because the army was there. Subsequently, there was a trial of even the INA soldiers there. So and then 1947 happens and the unfurling of the flag happens there. For me, it became a narrative of independent India, the symbol of independent India. Why? Because I believe in tomorrow and I believe in, I would say, a cute statement that I believe in the young people. Now, for me, my contribution was that when we did when the World Heritage nomination was happening, ASI was nominating that under criteria 2 and 3 as great piece of architecture. Okay, I agree. But what we were able to bring into that was criteria 6, which is it represents modern India, independent India. It's a symbol of independent India. And we need to, only part of the fort was protected, which is where all the Mughal buildings were, and the other areas which became the parade ground and so on and so forth, where all that was demolished was with the army. Of course, to due credit to acknowledge Mr. Jagmohan's intervention, the army moved out and the whole fort is given to the ASI. We were able to get the, when the inscription happened for World Heritage, it got the criteria 6, and so it got that recognition. Now this all helps the next generation, because in the 10 years of journey of the Red Fort, you can, and in 450 years of history of the Red Fort, where is 10 years? It's like a little thing. And we've done some bit, but having said that, it doesn't mean that in my life, I mean, of course, there's a lot of other things that went wrong with the Red Fort. We did a management plan that ASI had to implement in 10 years. We're already 7 years down or 5 years down. The committee that was constituted by the Supreme Court should go back and say, this is contempt of court, why is it not done? But maybe Rajeev won't do it, I won't do it, maybe you guys can do it. But the wheels keep churning, no? It doesn't stop.
So I'm not a failure. Yeah, please. You spoke about transformative governance. We work in transformative education. When I see the link, I mean, what I see, and that's why the hope, because transformative education is really, as Freddy may have said, that it's not about solving problems, but it's about posing problems. I mean, problem posing pedagogies, which even 10-year-olds and 8-year-olds can do. But the problem today is, I agree with you, and you're talking about the globalized person who's coming to build and take over this land. In education, it's the globalized world which looks at this as a billion-dollar market, which looks at skill as something and knowledge as something else. And people who have skill don't have knowledge. And the struggle is, and that's why for us the work is even much more, that from the youngest person to try and see that it's not just 2 into 2, which is being defined as some academics, but it's the head, the hand, and the heart. And where education will change, I mean, will help people to change lives and to change societies and to change thinking. But that struggle is now even sort of, for us, much more acute. But that's not just young people, but even younger people.
Yeah. I agree, pedagogy. Ankush, do you want to say anything about this pedagogy?
Well, coming from a boarding school which was established by the British, many things that you said were all Greek to me when I first met you. But over this journey of 1 year with you, I have come to realize that all this was quite natural to my understanding of how I have come to be. And on that note, along with Rajeev ji, I started formalizing a program of which I think Anita ji also attended one of the brainstorming sessions. It is called as Shilp Sagar, integrating traditional knowledge systems with contemporary pedagogy. And this is where I think the solution lies. I actually was meaning to ask you what is the solution, and throw light on this before you pass the mic.
You just gave it to us. It will come from you guys.
So, solution lies in realizing aptitude at the right age. Now, I did see you guys. You all restless all the time. As Rajeev ji was speaking and exchanging notes. But it is very important that we get a sense of this standing. And also, Raghu ji mentioned about internet and Facebook. And we don't do it with a sense of heroism or machoism, but we do it with a sense of perception of what it means to be not just Indian, but to be a South Asian. And this is what I think you as students of journalism need to take on and not spread the word.
Today we are talking about smart cities. I mean, our government is focusing on it. Sir, how justice is it where we have many places like Shadipur? Sir, is it not? Sir, is it not our duty to first uplift that kind of places, then we move on to smart cities?
So we've been asked some more questions. Should we take it together? There's some more there. Well, then, what do you want to tell us?
Very good evening. I and my friends here are from Delhi University. Here we are doing subjects like sustainable development practices and environment and resource management. So we, looking at environmental problems also and sustainability as such, we also think that transformative governance can somehow bring in. I think the issues are almost the same, and the communities that are affected are also on the similar lines. So we are trying to find the solutions in the same way. So my question is, you made a statement of the present of our past and the future of our past. So you are trying to tell how globalization is changing and stuff. So I want to ask, how much do we go back in the past to bring that? Like, how much do we have to de-develop or degrowth to get back what we lost now in this generation?
One more question.
Ma'am and sir, I am from IMC Piyush. Ma'am, मैं जानना चाहता था कि क्या हमें नहीं लगता कि हम गलत अप्रोच ले रहे हैं. हम ताजमहल को बचाने के लिए PIL डाल रहे हैं, लेकिन जो लोग ताजमहल बना रहे हैं उनको बचाने के लिए PIL नहीं डाल रहे हैं. उसमें समस्या ये है कि जो कलाकार या जो क्या कहते हैं आर्किटेक्ट जो हैं वो ताजमहल बनाते हैं, उन्हें पता है कि ताजमहल में कौन सा फूल किस जगह होना चाहिए. उसकी जगह पर हम किसी भी मिस्त्री को, किसी भी आर्किटेक्ट को ले जाके वहाँ बैठा दे रहे हैं. मधुबनी पेंटिंग्स जो हैं, मधुबनी पेंटिंग्स तब बचेंगी जब मधुबनी पेंटर्स बचेंगे, लेकिन हम मधुबनी पेंटिंग्स को बचा रहे हैं. जो सर ने एक बहुत बड़ी बात कही कि मैं कभी भी चीज़ों को बटोरता नहीं, मैं उन्हें एक जगह कलेक्ट नहीं करता. वो इसलिए क्योंकि अगर हम पेंटर्स को बचाएंगे तो हम पेंटिंग्स खुद अपने आप सामने आएंगे. उन कलाकारों को अगर हम बचा लें, लेकिन उसके लिए कोई प्रयास नहीं किया जा रहा. ये तो अच्छा है कि ताजमहल बचाना है या क्या कहते हैं लाल किला बचाना, हम एक PIL डाल देंगे, सुप्रीम कोर्ट उस पर एक्शन ले लेगा, लेकिन उन लोगों को बचाने के लिए हम क्या कर सकते हैं, मैं ये जानना चाहता था.
These three questions, should I take on immediately? They're all very important questions. Because the last one has been mentioned just now, let me explain what you're really saying is the art will stay alive as long as the artist does. Agar artist hi nahi hai, toh phir art kahan rahegi? Dekhiye, har artist ke liye visual reference bahut zaruri hota hai. Nahi to oral history mein sab lupt ho jata. To taaj, jab hum taaj ki baat karte hain, वो अगर ना हो तो हमें ताज के आर्टिस्ट के बारे में भी नहीं पता चलेगा. तो दोनों का अहमियत है. रेफरेंस बहुत जरूरी है. मैं बनाता हूँ जो उसकी अगर मैं हूबहू चित्र आप तक नहीं पहुँचा सकूँ तो मेरे को कौन पहचानेगा. मैंने भी तो वो पैंट कमीज पहन ली आजकल, बेकार मैं क्या बना रहा हूँ. वो ही उसी के कारण मेरी भी पहचान बनी है. तो पहचान के लिए हिस्ट्री और जो टेंजिबल मटेरियल है उसका रखना जरूरी है, नहीं तो ये सब लुप्त हो जाएगा. और उसके लिए कुछ नहीं है, आपके लिए म्यूजियम्स हैं, आपके लिए किताबें हैं, उसके लिए कुछ नहीं रह जाएगा. तो ये बहुत जरूरी है कि वो रखें. दूसरी बात, अब मगर मैं आपसे बिल्कुल सहमत हूँ कि अगर वो लुप्त हो जाता है तो इसका बचाने का भी मुझे इतना आनंद नहीं आता. वो ही गया तो सब गया. ये तो हमारी बात हमेशा रही है कि दोनों को साथ ही साथ चलना चाहिए. मैं आपकी बात से सहमत हूँ. इस बार दूसरा था हाउ मच टू डीकंस्ट्रक्ट द पास्ट. आई थिंक दैट्स अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट क्वेश्चन बट अ वेरी जनरल वन. एंड इट्स नॉट पॉसिबल टू से द पास्ट इन इटसेल्फ इज अ गोल्डन पास्ट. देयर आर मेनी थिंग्स दैट विल नीड टू इवॉल्व, नीड टू ड्रॉप, बी ड्रॉप्ड, नीड टू डीकंस्ट्रक्ट, नीड टू you know, move on. So, it's too general a question for me to answer, but it's a question that you have to ask at every turn. And, you know, there is a... I'm sorry, but there are many, many thoughts in my mind. I don't know what to say, but if you drink milk, there can be a whole conversation. There are stories, there are stories, there are stories, there are stories, and there are different symposium or something, but it's an important issue. How to relate to the past, to the, what is modernism? What does it entail in terms of this country's context itself? Smart cities, dekhiye, ghoshna karna to bada asaan hai. Ye to smart cities, maine kaha basti basna khel nahi hai. Baste 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 hai. To itna asaan nahi hai. Aap sochi ki aap 300 shahar
नहीं, लेकिन ये कि जो गवर्नेंस का, जो पॉलिटिक्स का ट्रेंड है, अगर स्मार्ट सिटीज की बात नहीं करेंगे, बड़े प्रोजेक्ट्स की बात नहीं करेंगे,
इन सब की जेबों में पैसा कहाँ से आएगा?
Yes,
और कितनी हवाओं में ऊंची ऊंची स्टेटमेंट्स दी जा रही हैं और देश में छोटी छोटी जिंदगियां बर्बाद हो रही हैं जिनकी शर्म आती है। तो देखिए एक बात ये भी कि ये पीरियड जो है ना ट्रांजिशन का, ये एक और तरह का है, तो वो भी गुजर जाएगा, ऐसी भी बात नहीं है।
और भी कम है मोहब्बत के साथ।
नहीं,
मोहब्बत बहुत जरूरी है, इसीलिए तो तू दीवाना है।
Between these two people, I have to take your question on smart cities, huh? See, because I'm doing two projects I'm doing for Ministry of Urban Development under that Hriday scheme for the city of Puri and Amritsar. Now to do, I mean, itna, you know, to keep our spirits a little high also, you can't just say sab kala hai. So smart cities mein, what is very interesting, what people are assuming smart cities means IT only. It's not IT. The part that he's saying, lobby hai, IT ki bahut strong. That they want technology, after all, you know, they want their business running. But to give government of India its due, they've actually asked the cities to decide what do they want to be smart in.
But how do they ask the city?
There's a process. Now, the point is, what this current Ministry of Urban Development is doing is actually asking the local governments to accept that. And of course, khichdi to pakti hai, but the point is, Delhi mein bhi काफी चर्निंग देखा है, यू नो, सिटी में क्या हो सकता है। बट अगर पीपल देमसेल्व्स आर नॉट आस्किंग, यू नो, यू मे नॉट वांट टू बी इन मेनस्ट्रीम पॉलिटिक्स, बट इफ द एवरेज सिटीजन डज नॉट मोबिलाइज हिमसेल्फ और हरसेल्फ टू से आई वांट टू बी स्मार्ट इन दिस, आई एम अमेज्ड कि सबसे पढ़े लिखे लोग आर्किटेक्ट से सब गलत बोल रहे होते हैं कि स्मार्ट सिटी स्कीम है क्या। किसी ने वेबसाइट पर जाके स्मार्ट सिटी का स्कीम ही नहीं पढ़ा है और प्रोसेस ही नहीं पढ़ा है। उससे अच्छा तो एक छोटा सा गांव है राजस्थान में नियर उदयपुर जहां पे मैं काम कर रही हूँ, वहां पर देवस्थान डिपार्टमेंट ने हमें एक थोड़ा सा प्रोजेक्ट दिया है गांव लेवल में। वो उन्होंने देवस्थान डिपार्टमेंट ने पैरेलल ही जाके उनका रसोदा जहां वो कुक करती है कम्युनिटी, उसको तोड़ दिया कि यहाँ पे अब हम एक मल्टी स्टोरी बिल्डिंग आपको बनाए देंगे, जहां पर आपको क्या बनाएंगे, जहां पे सारे पिलग्रिम आके रहेंगे, फलाना रहेंगे और वो सब। 60-70 लोग आसपास के गांव आके उस मंदिर में आके बैठ गए कि आपने तोड़ कैसे दिया, कि ये हमारी धरोहर है, यहाँ पे हम लोग जो भी खाना वाना बनाते थे एंड ऑल दैट फॉर द रिचुअल दिस थिंग, हमारे बिना अब आप ये बनाएंगे, इसमें हम कैसे खाना बनाएंगे, आप तो कमरे बना रहे हो यात्रियों के लिए। नाउ आई वुड से दे आर फार मोर एम्पावर्ड दैट दे केम। एंड वो एक और ट्रेजेडी, अलग बात है कि कुछ लोगों ने साइन किया था बिना ही पढ़े कि वो साइन किस पे कर रहे हैं, दैट्स द अदर ट्रेजेडी ऑफ दिस कंट्री। सो द मोमेंट यू फील यू आर गोइंग पीकिंग नाइसली, यू एक्चुअली डिप ऑल्सो सिमल्टेनियसली। वो लड़ भी रहे हैं पर उन्होंने गलत कागज पे साइन भी किया हुआ था या किसी ने उनके साथ तमाशा भी किया था। नाउ कमिंग बैक टू द स्मार्ट सिटी कॉन्सेप्ट, इफ द कम्युनिटी, इफ पीपल देमसेल्व्स आर नॉट गोइंग टू बी सेल्फ एम्पावर्ड एंड से लुक दिस इज व्हाट वी वांट फॉर आवर सिटी, यू आर गोइंग टू बी बुलडोज्ड, यू नो, यू विल हैव ओनली आईटी। अजमेर में JNNURM पे उन्होंने सारे दरगाह के सामने अंडरग्राउंड बिजली के केबल्स डाल दिए, पर वो बिजली के केबल्स काम ही नहीं करते एंड वो जवाहरलाल नेहरू अर्बन रिन्यूअल मिशन खत्म हो गया। अब वो केबल डली थी, किसी ने पैसा खाया है, केबल भी पड़ गई है, पर अब वो चलती नहीं है क्योंकि अब उसमें पानी पड़ जाता है। नाउ सिटीजंस आर एज मच रिस्पांसिबल, सो आई थिंक वी गॉट सम अदर एरियाज टू एंगेज विद आल्सो, यू नो, एंड नॉट जस्ट कैन डू क्वेश्चन।
माय क्वेश्चन गोज अराउंड द सेम वे, आई रिसेंटली विजिटेड जयपुर एंड हैपेंड टू टॉक विद द लोकल पीपल, सो द कांसेप्ट ऑफ स्मार्ट सिटीज लाइक मेट्रो इज कमिंग इन जयपुर, द लोकल्स not at all happy because it's no use to them and Jaipur doesn't need metro, it's just a push, just a name tag, metro it's coming. But if you ask the people a level up, they're proud that the Jaipur is getting their metro to their city, they're proud, like my city is no less than Delhi now, Delhi metro and Jaipur, like metro is coming, some places underground metro is coming, all the old buildings are getting shaken up gradually and everything, and then eventually it will get demolished because it will be not suitable to, not a habitable building, so they will be eventually getting demolished. No line of where the progress should be made, not be made. Delhi, old Changi Chowk, Hoskazi destroyed, nobody know, because the need of metro is more to people rather than the old things. Coming to ASI, like I've been hearing, like seeing it and also listening from many, like as you mentioned the report also, so many things which ASI, like ASI, is it that ASI is so rigid in terms of its work that it could just directly put cement over the lime or whatever, like, so is it very rigid and no one can deal with it? Or like, because they are not only Redford, there are many monuments, just putting up iron railing like that only, putting up plaster cement instead of putting lime, many things, many things. So is it that like no help can be done to that, or like what? Like that's a question, like a genuine question. I feel that where's the help? Like if ASI is a strong body, there are other bodies also working together for the conservation. So is it that ASI, nobody can deal with the ASI, what ASI is doing it? Or is it that the government, it's a government body which is very strong enough, nobody can deal with what it's doing it? So
you're asking whether ASI, in our experiences, is the nodal body that can be relied upon for the conservation of this country.
I know that.
You have no choice.
There are other many conservation people working, many together working for it. But ASI, of course, is a major body.
Yeah. It needs restructuring, that's all. And some priorities. How about that?
Government go and they, I can't believe this, that people pass by and they can't even see that such brutal destruction is happening there. And where does the government go there then at that point of time? And after that, such organization comes and they take the charge. But there are certain, when we talk about smart cities or taking lands from people, from skilled people that deserve so much respect, and when we take their livelihoods and we build something like a smart city or a tower or a skyscraper, there are some laws by norms, and there are some many norms are there to construct such skyscrapers and towers. And these all are passed by government. The whole project is passed by government. Why there is no action taken by government then and there?
Achha, dekhiye, main aap kisi ne pucha nahi ki Supreme Court ka natija kya tha? Ye pehla project tha jispe all five counts hum jeete. सुप्रीम कोर्ट ने कहा, मैंने कहा ताली नहीं मारी हुई जीते, और हमने बोला पहली बार भी कंजर्वेशन मैनेजमेंट प्लान का होना जरूरी आधा हो गया कि यू हैव टू हैव इट। फिर एक कमेटी बिठाई गई, अब कमेटी में बैठी, अब यहाँ गलतियां शुरू हो गई। इट्स गवर्नमेंट कैन टेक एक्शन, बट दैट्स व्हाट इज द गवर्नमेंट, इट्स अस। वो फिर कमेटी कभी मिलती थी, नहीं मिलती थी, उनके एक मेंबर यहाँ पे हैं जो पायनियर है इस फील्ड में, और इसमें इतना काम किया, नन्ही नन्ही यहाँ बैठी है, और वो उसकी भी अपनी प्रॉब्लम थी, उनसे आप सुन लीजिए। मगर ये जो ढांचा जो बाद में जो हुआ वो ना के बराबर था, तो जीतना जो है वो तो उसमें दांत नहीं है। कोर्ट जो कह रहा है कि करो, वो सरकार के लिए, अब जैसे वो जो उन्होंने वो पुल बना दिया वहाँ पे, वापस तो पैसे नहीं इसको तोड़ने के लिए, हम कहाँ ठीक करेंगे उसको, बैठे रहो। ये भी तो बात है ना, हमने तो बना दिए जो पैसे से, तो आई मीन कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ द सॉल्यूशन, बट आई एम टेलिंग यू दैट व्हाई सॉल्यूशंस आर देयर इन द गवर्नमेंट टू टेक एक्शन, एंड द कोर्ट्स आर अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट पार्ट ऑफ आवर डेमोक्रेसी देयर, बट द वन हैज टू बी अप, उसमें हमारी गलती भी है, हम लोग उसको आगे नहीं ले जा पाए। अब आई डोंट नो हाउ मच लड़ झगड़ कर मीठा को तो अपॉइंट किया उन्होंने कि भाई तुम उसको, मीठा का भी प्लान मेरे ख्याल इतना अच्छा बढ़िया, कितना मोटा होगा इतना तो होगा मोटा, तो उसको कितने लोगों ने पढ़ा, वो कुछ तो ये कह रही कि उन लोगों ने मान लिया, मगर मेरी नज़र में ज़्यादा से ज़्यादा तो अभी भी उन्होंने पढ़ा नहीं है। उसको उसके ऊपर अमल करने के लिए जागरूकता, लोगों तक पहुँचने की तरीका, जिसमें मीडिया का बहुत हाथ है, उसको हम जैसे चीजें देखते थे और उसको एक सेकंड नहीं रोकते थे. अब तो आपने देखा उसमें डेट्स लिखी थी लाल किला का. मैं हर दिन वहां जाता था और चुपचाप जब मुझे नहीं ले जा रहे थे तो मैंने ऑफिस के दूसरे लड़कों को भेज भेज के मालिक को भी बताते कि इसको बाहर रखो. तो फिर लोगों से फोटो लगवानी थी. तो आपको आपको आप लोगों को जागरूक रहना पड़ेगा. ये आपका देश है. हम जो कर रहे थे कर रहे थे. और जब तक आप जगह नहीं रखेंगे तो सरकार भी सोएगी, कोर्ट भी सोएंगे और उसकी जो एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन है, जो पिलर्स है, पॉलिटिशियंस तो वैसे भी सोने में मस्त है, एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन
लूटने में मस्त,
लूट के सोना. फिर एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन भी लूट मची है. और अगर कोर्ट भी उसके पीछे नहीं जाए, कोर्ट भी कह रहे हैं हमने तो कर दिया, तुमने कहा था हम क्या करेंगे. सो कॉन्स्टेंट बिगिनिंग्स, ये आप छोड़ नहीं सकते. इसमें कोई थकान नहीं आ सकती. ये आपकी लेगेसी, इसमें आप छोड़ नहीं सकते.
बाकी और आप जैसे 20-50 बच्चे वहां जाके बैठ जाएं तो प्रेस भी भागी चली आएगी. नहीं, ये सच की बात सच में
हो चुका है.
यू हैव टू टेक ओवर ना. अब आप हमें मत क्वेश्चन कीजिए. हम तो बुद्धू बन गए, बुद्धा बन गए, बुढ़े हो गए.
बुद्धू बुद्धा बुद्धा ऐसा वेरी गुड वन. बुद्धा बुद्धू बुढ़े बहुत
बढ़िया.
थैंक यू सर. दिस वन क्वेश्चन सर, मैं दो चीजें जानना चाहता हूँ. एक राजीव सर से और एक मैम से.
जी,
एक अभी आपने जो फोटोग्राफ दिखाए थे ना, वो इतने पुराने हैं. मैंने अभी 4-5 महीने पहले फोटोग्राफी की, जो जोगी है बाबू जी की फोटो, उनके फोटोग्राफ आप ब्लैक एंड व्हाइट करके वही फोटोग्राफ देखो तो पता नहीं लगेगा कि वो तब के और ये वही हाल है अभी उनका. वो ऐसे ही घरों में रहते हैं, ऐसे ही खुले में रह रहे जो जोगी
वगैरह.
और वहाँ जो कसीदाकारी का काम करते हैं उनके पास में गया तो वो एक चद्दर होती है, वो कसीदा करके देते हैं 15 या 15 से लेके 50-75 रुपए तक. वही चीज बाजार में आके 12-13 हजार में बिकती है.
बिचौलियों का एक जो आनंद राम का कॉन्सेप्ट था ना, जो देख रहे थे आप, दैट वाज टू से कि यहीं पर टूरिस्ट आए, तभी तो टूरिस्ट सेंटर था, कि जो बिचौलियों के हाथ में जो हमारी कलाएं हैं वो हम खुद डायरेक्टली संपर्क जोड़ सके. मगर अभी तो आप शादीपुर डिपो नहीं जा सकते ना, आपके पैर इतनी बड़ी दलदल में फंस जाएंगे. तो हमने कहा था कि इसी जगह को ऐसा बनाइए जिसके इनके ग्राहक इन तक पहुंचे, ना कि ये लोग बिचौलियों के हाथ में बिके. दैट वाज द मेन पर्पस कि एम्पावरमेंट. तब आप जैसे दिल्ली हाट है, अब आप कितने लोग जानते, दिल्ली हाट का जो आइडिया था वो तो एम्पावर करने का था. वहां पे कितने लोग हैं जो एम्पावर्ड है, वो तो सारे बिचौलिया लोग बैठे हैं वहां पर. उनको उनकी जो अथॉरिटी थी वो उनके हाथ में नहीं है, वो सरकार के हाथ में है. जिसके हमारी पूरी आनंद राम की स्कीम ये थी कि हम जैसे लोगों को उसमें 1 रुपया वो देकर एम्प्लॉय कर रहे हैं. मगर ये है उनकी संस्था. शायद एक्चुअली इसी कारण हमें जमीन नहीं मिली.
और एक और चीज, मैंने उनसे नाम पूछा तो वो बोले नाम नहीं बताएंगे, आप किसी एनजीओ से तो नहीं हो. सब आते हैं, नाम पूछते हैं, लिस्ट बनाते हैं और चले जाते, वापस कभी नहीं आते. तो मैंने एक एनजीओ का नाम पता किया, उसके ऑफिस गया, वो एनजीओ चल रहा था, उसके ऑफिस पर ताला लगा था और फर्श की जमीन पर ऐसे लगती कि 6 महीने तक यहाँ पे आया गया नहीं. और एक क्वेश्चन मैम से है, मैम किसी नई योजना के लिए लोगों को वहाँ से हटा के, जैसे पुनर्वास कर दिया जाता है, पर किसी हेरिटेज साइट को बचाने के लिए वहाँ जो व्यावसायिक गतिविधियाँ होती है वो बंद नहीं होती. जैसे जैसलमेर का सोनार किला है, वो वर्ल्ड हेरिटेज साइट में यूनेस्को की, वहाँ पर बहुत बार बताया गया कि वहाँ की जो व्यावसायिक गतिविधियाँ वो नहीं हटाई गई तो थोड़े सालों में वो गिर जाएगा. और वो गिर भी रहा है. अभी वहाँ काम चल रहा है, आप जाके देखो तो रोना आएगा कि ये वर्ल्ड हेरिटेज साइट है. तो वहाँ की जो व्यावसायिक गतिविधियाँ हैं उनको क्यों नहीं हटाया जाता. और दूसरा, वहाँ पे जो एक गांव है लुद्रवा करके, उस गांव में एएसआई द्वारा रोक लगे, बोर्ड लगे हुए कि यहाँ पे नया काम नहीं हो सकता या वो सब, फिर भी उस गाँव में धर्मशालाएँ बनाई जाती है, जो ट्रस्ट है उनके पास पैसा आता है और वो सब पुराने घर उनको हटाया जा रहा. तो उन धर्मशालाओं में कोई ठहरने नहीं आता, उनके पास पैसा बहुत आता है, वो बनाते हैं और वो पुरानी चीजें हटा देते हैं.
पुरानी चीजें मतलब घर,
पुराने घर थे जो बहुत राजाओं को, वो जैसलमेर से भी पहले बना था वो गाँव. तो ये क्यों हो रहा है?
बहुत लंबा आंसर है, तो इसलिए तो आपको कंजर्वेशन पढ़नी पड़ेगी।
कब फेंके ये काम हम लोगों को भाई? इंडियन इंटरनेशनल सेंटर आप क्या सोचते हैं गढ़ बन गया?
मतलब आप गांव पूरा हटा देते हो कहीं पे बांध बनाने के लिए, वहाँ पे जो व्यवसायिक गतिविधियाँ हो रही है उससे जो पानी या पूरा जो वो रिश्ता है उससे दीवार उसको क्यों नहीं हटाया जा रहा व्यवसायिक गतिविधियों को?
तो अब इसके
ये थोड़ा मुश्किल और लंबा जवाब है, इसलिए मैं इतना इंगेज नहीं करना चाह रही थी, क्योंकि ये थोड़ा आपको ये भी सोचना पड़ेगा कि जो बाहर का, सिर्फ आपको एक सोचने के लिए मैं बात बताती हूँ कि इंटरनेशनल जो वेस्टर्न कॉन्सेप्ट्स है कंजर्वेशन के, जो हमारा आर्कियोलॉजिकल सर्वे ऑफ इंडिया ने भी इनहेरिट किया, फर्स्ट एक्ट 1904 में बना था, जिसमें ये है कि वहाँ पर सिर्फ, और फिर वही 1958 पोस्ट इंडिपेंडेंस में वही एक्ट फिर से लागू हुआ, उसमें साइट्स ऑफ आर्कियोलॉजिकल इम्पोर्टेंस को बदल के उन्होंने साइट्स ऑफ नेशनल इम्पोर्टेंस कर दिया था, बाकी सब कुछ वही था। अब मैं इसमें आपको ये कहना चाहूँगी कि जापान ने ये वेस्टर्न कॉन्सेप्ट टूल है कि आप चीज़ को फ्रीज कर दें, और उसमें भी बहुत लेयरिंग है, वो मैं अपना कॉम्प्लेक्स ही करना चाहूँगी। जापान ने अपना एक कन्वेंशन, एक अपना बनाया नारा डॉक्यूमेंट ऑफ ऑथेंटिसिटी, जो उन्होंने 25 साल पहले बनाया था, जिसमें उन्होंने ये वेस्टर्न वर्ल्ड को बताया कि देखिए आपका एक अंडरस्टैंडिंग है कोई चीज़ ऑथेंटिक क्या होती है, ये हमारा धरोहर है, इसको ऐसे ही रहना चाहिए, हाँ, फ्रीज फ्रोजन इन टाइम। जापान ने ये कहा कि देखिए हमारे लकड़ी के मंदिर हैं, हम उनको खोलते हैं, जब वो डिके हो जाती है लकड़ी, उसको हम उसी प्रोसेस, चाहे वो पूजा पाठ हो, चाहे वो ज्वाइनरी हो, चाहे वो लकड़ी ढूंढने का तरीका हो, जो भी हो, हम वो अपने वही ट्रेडिशन, वही आर्टिजन, वो सब को करके हम उसको रीवर्क कर देते हैं, जो खराब है निकाल दिया, जो रखा अच्छा है वो रखा और चेंज किया। तो उन्होंने नारा डॉक्यूमेंट ऑफ ऑथेंटिसिटी बताया, जहाँ जापान ने अपना फिलॉसफी और अपना इनटेंजिबल और टेंजिबल मिला के दुनिया को बताया कि ये हम ऐसा करेंगे और हमारा ये हमारी धरोहर है। अब जैसे आप जैसलमेर की बात कर रहे हैं, अब जैसलमेर में लोग रहते हैं, प्रॉब्लम क्या हो रहा है कि सीवेज लाइन है, वो वहाँ सीपेज हो रही है, और सीपेज करके आपकी दीवारों में फ़र्क पड़ रहा है, किसी ने कुछ रिपेयर किया और बाहर की जो मूलियाँ हैं जो है उसको भी लेवल चेंज कर दिए, प्रॉब्लम ड्रेनेज की है, प्रॉब्लम लोगों के रहने की नहीं है। तो नहीं, पर मैं आपको
लोगों के रहने की नहीं, जो वहाँ पे होटल्स बन रही है नए रोज,
हाँ, तो मैं आपको वही बात कह रही हूँ कि अगर आपने मैनेज करना है तो आपने चेंज मैनेज करना है, आपने फ्रीज नहीं करना है। अब इंडिया ने कभी भी इतना, हम अपने ऐसे ऐसे मीटिंग में बैठते हैं, बातचीत करते हैं, हमने अपना फिलॉसफी ऑफ कंजर्वेशन, अब टेंजिबल और इनटेंजिबल, हमारा लिविंग ट्रेडिशन जो राजीव जी बात करते हैं, और जो टेंजिबल है जो लाल किला है, तो ये चीज को जोड़ते हुए हमने अपना कोई नजरिया दुनिया को नहीं दिखाया कि हम क्या करना चाहते हैं। तो और जितनी हमारी पॉपुलेशन है, अगर आप फ्रीज करने लगेंगे तो जो चीज बची हुई है वो भी टूट जाएगी, क्योंकि जो लोगों की आप बात कर रहे हैं जिनको घर नहीं मिल रहा है, वो लड़ेंगे कि देखिए जमीन आप जैसे क्वेश्चन था, ताजमहल आप बचा रहे और हमारा घर तो आप बचा नहीं पा रहे, तो फिर हर चीज में कॉन्फ्लिक्ट बन जाता है। तो जब हम अपना, वी आर नॉट रेडी टू एंगेज विद आर past and present to arrive at principles for future, because of which that stage is khali, jahan par sab log chalang laga ke apna hi koi kisi ko maar raha hai, koi kisi ka gaay hai, kisi ka bhais hai, aise aise ladaiyan kar rahe hain, aur monument ka bhi yahi halat hai, because we have not engaged with our knowledge system to arrive at principles for change
of
the way forward, and our solution प्रैक्टिकल में देने की जरूरत नहीं है। वी हैव टू अग्री ऑन प्रिंसिपल्स। इंडिया इज अबाउट प्रिंसिपल्स, नॉट अबाउट फाइंडिंग सॉल्यूशन फॉर द अदर पर्सन। सॉल्यूशंस आप ढूंढ लेंगे अपने।
Can I just add one thing before we close quickly? Because you raised this question of transformative governance, I just wanted to point out something which we started with, like Raju was mentioning, like, you know, this doesn't look like an IIC crowd at all, you know. So if you come to these lectures, you actually see that IIC has this kind of crowd for our, so what I mean to say is, when we are actually, this whole thing that we are doing is not just a lecture, but this is a process which is in itself transformative at various levels, multiple levels. We are actually acutely, keenly aware of the multiple level changes that are happening. Like IIS, space like IIS is changing for an organization like us, which does not have any kind of backing, any kind of resources, any kind of networking, you know, it's changing just because on the ground there is this population. How can you stop them? Like, you know, when they come and sit here to listen to a people who are two generations, three generations older than them, and they're keenly attending, they're sitting through, then how can you stop them? How can you say at 8 o'clock you must stop? How can you say that, you know, I will not open this door because this is just two rooms allotted to us. They open it for us because so things will change. And these need not be like overtly stated. I'm just saying this just to say that, you know, this is a process which is happening even without our knowing it, you know. Thank you.
Thank you. On that note, we are closing this program. As Rizya said, IIC insists on closing at 8, but now we have exceeded the time. I would like to really extend our heartfelt, deepest gratitude to Rajeev Sethi and Gurmeet Rai, Raghu Rai, for jointly crafting a beautiful evening and engaging and drawing everybody into this conversation, literally drawing all of us into this conversation. And I would like to mention that the question on design is a seminal question in this series, which will be explored further by more practitioners in this field, including Pradeep Krishnan, Aman Nath, and Jyotindra Jain. These are lectures. Ritesh Nanda is sharing one of the lectures. So, on the 25th of October, we have Kavita Sharma talking about education and governance. So, we request your presence there, and I extend heartfelt thanks to the Hindi Journalism Department of the Indian Institute of Mass Communication, the Sustainable Development Department of the Terry University, NIFT, students from NIFT are here, and students from Pearl Academy are here, as students from School of Planning and Architecture are also part of the audience. We thank everybody. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.